Welcome to St. Bartholomew the Apostle Church. Today, we celebrate the sacred liturgy for the fifth Sunday of Lent. Our entrance hymn is In These Days of Lenten Journey.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome, everyone, to St. Bartholomew the Apostle Church. It's great to be with you today as we celebrate Mass for the fifth Sunday of Lent. And there's an extra added joy. It's not just those that are up here in the sanctuary. We have many of our parishioners that are represented by the images that you've sent. And so it's little, but it goes a long way. And so thank you for sending us your pictures. Even though we're not united physically, we are spiritually. My friends, God has promised to raise the dead to new life through Christ, who died and rose again in glory. Rejoicing in this promise, let us examine our hearts, renounce our sins, and ask God's forgiveness, that we may be ready to share in Christ's risen glory. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Kyrie eleison.
Let us pray. By your help, we beseech you, Lord our God. May we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, O my people, I will open your graves and have you rise from them, and bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and have you rise from them, O my people. I will put my spirit in you that you may live, and I will settle you upon your land. Thus you shall know that I am the Lord. I have promised, and I will do it, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Now a man was ill, Lazarus from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who had anointed the Lord with perfumed oil and dried his feet with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was ill. So the sisters sent word to Jesus saying, "Master, the one you love is ill." When Jesus heard this, he said, "This illness is not to end in death, but is for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he remained for 2 days in the place where he was. Then, after this, he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just trying to stone you, and you want to go back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day? If one walks during the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks at night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him." He said this, and then told them, "Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but I am going to awaken him." So the disciples said to him, "Master, if he is asleep, he will be saved." But Jesus was talking about his death, while they thought that he meant ordinary sleep. So then Jesus said to them clearly, "Lazarus has died, and I am glad for you that I was not there, that you may believe. Let us go to him." So Thomas, called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go to die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." "Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary secretly, saying, "The teacher is here and is asking for you." As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. For Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So when the Jews who were with her in the house, comforting her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out, they followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled and said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Sir, come and see." And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died?" So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, "Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me, but because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them, "Untie him and let him go." Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I had a feeling this was going to happen. I already received a text from a couple of parishioners saying that somebody was sitting in their pew, their spot. We all have our spot in the pew. But thank you for sending your pictures. It certainly makes Mass a little more meaningful for us to see your faces, to see these beautiful faces of our parishioners. So thank you for doing that, and we encourage everyone, if you haven't already, to send in an image of yourself or your family, and so this way we could at least see you as we celebrate the sacred mystery. You know, Father David's mother tells me a story that when Father David was a little boy and he was afraid of the dark, some things never change. One night, his mother told him to go to the back porch and bring her the broom. And Father David turned to his mother and said, "Mom, I don't want to go out there. It's dark." And the mother smiled reassuringly to him, saying, "You don't have to be afraid of the dark. Jesus is out there. He'll look after you. He'll protect you." Father David looked at his mother real hard and asked, "Are you sure he's out there?" "Yes, I'm sure. He's everywhere. He's always ready to help you when you need him," she said. Father David thought about that for a moment, and then he went to the back door and cracked it a little. He said, "Jesus, Jesus, if you're out there, would you please hand me the broom?" You know.
She also said I was her favorite, yeah, by the way.
That's between you and your brothers. You know, very soon we will recall the death of Jesus, but today we are confronted with the death of Lazarus. It seems we're being asked to think about what we would prefer not to think about, and that is death. And to ponder the question, "Jesus, are you really out there? Are you really out there in the dark? Jesus, are you really with us in this pandemic?" In answer, let us offer three images for you that indicate Jesus is indeed out there in the dark and with us in this pandemic. A few years ago, Father David and I had the opportunity to visit the 9/11 memorial on the site where the World Trade Center tower stood. As you know, the memorial is inscribed with thousands of names of those who lost their lives on 9/11. As we walked the ground, A couple of things stood out. The first thing we noticed was silence. Silence. As crowded as it was, there was a hush of reverence over the whole setting. The next thing that caught our attention was how different people approached the inscribed names. Some were obviously there just as spectators. They could touch lots of names, pass them over quickly, and have no reaction whatsoever. To them, the names were just letters carved into granite. But to others, those names, or rather this name, was a reason to pause, to cry. They moved very slowly as if approaching something sacred, and then touched the name. Some wept, others were still lost in grief. Some stood quietly as they ran their fingers gently over the letters. Some even knelt. As we watched this ritual unfold, we couldn't help but wonder what the relationship between the living person and the name, husband, wife, son, daughter, mother, sister, brother, friend. It had to be something special, or it would not have solicited such a profound reaction. Of course, the answer is that to those who knew the person behind the name, it represents all of the memories, the history, the personality and intimacy created by these two people. It is the depth of the relationship that makes the connection. The investment of life one person made in another person. It represents someone who made a difference to the one who knows that person. And so too, Jesus. He said, I know mine, and mine know me. I no longer call you servants, but friends. So we are not anonymous to Jesus. He runs his fingers over our names and claims us as his very own. Before and after our deaths. That is our hope.
Another image, and one not from our family experience. The luminous paintings of the great French artist Pierre Auguste Renoir are, as you may know, aglow with life and light and color. He seemed to put light inside the people he painted. Remarkably, as you may also know, for the last 20 or so years of his life, his most productive years, by the way, Renoir was terribly crippled with arthritis. His hands were twisted and gnarled. His wrists, his arms, even his spine were ravaged by the disease. He couldn't even stand as he worked. He had to sit as he painted, and he shifted in his chair by his assistants. At times, the pain was so great as he worked that beads of perspiration would stand out on his face. On one occasion, one of his students said to him, "Why do you go on and torture yourself like this?" The great painter looked at the canvas that he was working on and replied, "The pain passes, but the beauty remains. The pain passes, but the beauty remains." My friends, that is the promise we have. Untie him and set him free. That is to say, after the ravages of sickness and death, after the oppression of this horrible pandemic, the beauty of love and eternity remains. A final image. A long time ago, there lived a boy whose parents had died. He was taken in by an aunt who raised him as her own child. Years later, after he had grown up and left his aunt, he received a letter from her. She was in terminal illness, and from the tone of the letter, he knew that she was afraid of death. This man whom she had raised and touched wrote her a letter in which he said this: "It is now 30 years since I, a little boy of 6, was left quite alone in the world. You sent me word that you would give me a home and be a mother to me. I've never forgotten the day when I made the long journey of 10 miles to your house. I can still recall my disappointment when, instead of coming for me yourself, you sent your servant, Cesar, a stranger, to fetch me. I well remember my tears and my anxiety as, perched high on the horse and clinging tight to Caesar, I rode off to my new home. Night fell before we finished the journey, and as it grew dark, I became even more afraid. 'Do you think she'll go to bed before I get there?' I asked Caesar anxiously. 'Oh no,' he said, 'she'll be sure to stay up for you. When we get out of these woods, you'll see her light shining in the window.' We did ride out in the clearing, and there was your light. I remember that you were waiting at the door, that you put your arms around me so tight, that you lifted me, a tired, frightened little boy, down from the horse. You had a fire burning, a hot supper waiting. After supper, you took me to my new room. You heard me say my prayers. Then you sat with me until I fell asleep. You probably realize why I'm trying to recall this memory now. Very soon,' he wrote, 'God is going to send for you and take you to a new home. I'm trying to tell you that you needn't be afraid of the summons or of the strange journey or of that strange messenger of death. God can be trusted. God can be trusted to do as much for you as you did for me so many years ago. At the end of the road, you'll find love and a welcome waiting, and you'll be safe in God's care. I'm going to watch and pray for you until you're out of sight, and I shall wait for the day when I make the same journey myself and find you waiting at the end of the road to greet me.'" My friends, notice the symbols. Cesar, the stranger, is death. The light at the end of the journey is Jesus. The house is the many rooms in the Father's house that Jesus promises us. The supper is the heavenly banquet, and God is the loving aunt. It's a homecoming story. It is gospel, it is hope, it is promise.
We see this on full display in our gospel today. Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days, and Jesus Christ calls him by name, orders him to come out, and he does. Death itself obeys Christ the Lord. The crowd must have been stupefied, wide-eyed with disbelief, awe, and wonder that silenced them as Lazarus stepped out of that tomb and then burst forth in a storm of joy and celebration. Martha and Mary must have been so awestruck and ecstatic that they didn't know who to embrace first, their brother or their Lord, Jesus Christ. Lazarus, as soon as the cloths were removed, surely gazed into our Lord's shining eyes with the deepest love and most determined, courageous loyalty that he had ever experienced.
You know, it's no coincidence that the church presents this scene to us towards the end of the Lenten liturgical climax. 2 weeks ago, Christ told the woman at the well that he was the Messiah. Last week, he cured a man born blind, something that no one had ever done before. And now he tops everything. He tops everything by raising Lazarus from the dead. You see, Jesus knows that in order to fulfill the Father's plan of salvation, he will soon have to suffer humiliation, be tortured, and put to death. As that moment draws near, he performs miracle after miracle to bolster his disciples' faith, to give them courage, so that their faith will survive the horrors of Calvary. And he is doing it to bolster our faith too, so that we can continue to hope, and even in the midst of our own crosses, which are nothing less than pieces of his cross.
Friends, the little boy's question, "Jesus, are you out there?" must have been Lazarus's question. "Jesus, are you out there?" The good news is that he was. For Lazarus, for you, for me. That good news assures us that together we can develop the faith and courage to survive these difficult and challenging times.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Trusting that God always hears us, let us now offer our prayers for our needs and the needs of our sisters and brothers everywhere.
For the church, that we may be for the world a source of faith, strength, and courage during the darkest times.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For government officials, that God will lead them in protecting the health and well-being of all whom they serve, particularly the most vulnerable and powerless of society.
We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who will suffer financially from loss of employment and income from our current health crisis, may God open the hearts of those who have much to assist and support them in their time of need.
We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all medical personnel, emergency workers, and all those whose jobs require daily contact with the public, may God sustain and bless them in their work and keep them safe from harm.
We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are ill, particularly those suffering from the coronavirus, that God will bring them healing and peace.
We pray.
And for the faithful departed, that they may be welcomed by the saints and angels to God's heavenly kingdom. We remember especially Father Jorge Ortiz Garay, Catherine Riley McCabe, Sylvia Dante, and Joseph Carroll Sr.
We pray.
God of life, you are the source and destiny of our lives. Kindle your spirit within us, strengthen our faith when it is tested, and hear the prayers we offer this day in the name of Jesus Christ, our eternal Lord. Amen. Friends, on behalf of Father John and the community, just wanted to say thank you for all who have responded to our plea to continue your weekly offering. These are difficult times, and we ask that you continue to support the mission of St. Bartholomew the Apostle Church. Thank you. Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept his sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Hear us, Almighty God, and having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as true man, he wept for Lazarus, his friend, and as eternal God raised him from the tomb. Just as, taking pity on the human race, he leads us by sacred mysteries to new life. Through him, the hosts of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever.
May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Therefore, Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at table, he himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis our Pope and Joseph our Bishop and all the bishops and your entire people.
Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let us ask God to unite himself with us in the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Friends, please know that we will continue to celebrate weekday Mass Monday through Friday. It will be live streamed at 9 a.m. and then broadcast later in the day at 5 p.m. on the local TV stations. You could also please make sure to check our website and Facebook for any updates. And this week we will be continuing with our novena meditations to our Mother of Perpetual Help, which immediately follows weekday Mass. Know that we miss you, we love you, we look forward to the day when we can be together again to celebrate Eucharist, but until that day, be assured of our prayers and support and our affection for you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. Bless, O Lord, your people who long for the gift of your mercy, and grant that what at your prompting they desire, they may receive by your generous gift, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever and ever.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.